When President Obama was inaugurated, he said that he was going to have the most transparent administration in history. And yet there have been record numbers of prosecutions under the Espionage Act against whistleblowers. They have invoked the state secrets privilege repeatedly to try to quash lawsuits against Bush, Cheney, Rumsfeld, all these war criminals from the Murder Incorporated era of Bush and Cheney. The Obama administration has protected them from any accountability by using the state secrets privilege. They are regularly denying legitimate FOIA requests of journalists, freedom of information requests, to try to understand the secret policies. Members of the US Senate still have not gotten an adequate or thorough answer on the standard that is used by this White House to place an American citizen on the kill list. As far as we know right now, they have meetings on Tuesdays, which they call their Terror Tuesday meetings, and they order bulk food from Costco and pizzerias around the White House. I shit you not, that's true. And they sit around with baseball cards, deciding who's gonna live or die, who should be elevated to the kill list, who do we wanna try to get one of our allies to capture, who are we watching? At times there have been teenage girls that have ended up on that board for some form of consideration. So what we have is the notion of due process for Americans or non-Americans alike, replaced by Terror Tuesday meetings sponsored by Costco. We have the right to a trial replaced by teams from the CIA, the NSA, and the Joint Special Operations Command trying to track down the locations of these individuals. You have the prosecution phase, which is the NSA gathering metadata and trying to build a picture of who's in touch with whom, who's been in the same place with each other, where has this SIM card been, who is it texting, who is it calling? And then you have the President of the United States serving as the judge to issue the death penalty, and then the executioner, most often, is a drone that fires a missile at these individuals, almost none of whom ever have been charged with a crime, and against whom we may not have any actual evidence. That's the state of affairs right now. And it doesn't matter, American or non-American, it's irrelevant to me in almost every way. I don't believe that American lives are worth a penny more than non-American lives. But how a society treats its own citizens is a good indication of how it views citizens of other countries around the world. President Obama finally, after 5 years in office, admitted that he authorized drone strikes that killed 4 American citizens. I believe that there have been many more American citizens killed in these operations, but he acknowledged that there have been 4 Americans killed in drone strikes. One of them, perhaps most famously, was Anwar al-Awlaki, who was born in New Mexico and became a very prominent imam in Washington, D.C. Before 9/11, and was a major figure in U.S. media coverage of 9/11. He was on PBS NewsHour, profiled in the Washington Post, was on Talk of the Nation on NPR, and he was called upon by American media outlets post 9/11 to try to make sense of the experience of many American Muslims in the United States who were on the one hand horrified, as all of us were, by the events of 9/11, and then on the other hand facing hate attacks and vicious attacks against businesses and taxi drivers and organizations being spied on. And al-Awlaki was a commentator, and I remember him because I actually tried to book him when I was a producer at Democracy Now! At the time. And that's why his name rang a bell with me. And then in the first month of 2010, we learned that al-Awlaki had been placed on a kill list and that the U.S. was hunting him in Yemen. So I started to research al-Awlaki and discovered that he had said many things that I found utterly reprehensible. The calls for violence, he at one point named cartoonists who had drawn demeaning pictures of the Prophet Muhammad, named them and called on people to go and assassinate them, including a young woman in Washington State who had to go underground, change her name, and be totally relocated. He did things that I think potentially he could have been indicted for, he could have been charged for. I certainly thought that he was an utterly reprehensible individual, but largely, what he seemed to be engaging in was free speech, as reprehensible as I found it. And if he was engaged in some kind of speech that equated criminality, then charge him with a crime. But what it appears happened is that the Obama administration didn't want to bring him back to the United States to put him on trial, that it would be more convenient to just kill him. So they sentenced Anwar Awlaki to death without even charging him with a crime. And after a multi-year hunt for him, they killed him in a tiny village called Kashef in the north of Yemen, which is interesting because his tribal roots are in the south of Yemen. So he was in a place, they had been repeatedly drone bombing the area where they thought he was, and it turned out he wasn't there. So all those drone strikes where they killed all sorts of people because they were looking for Awlaki probably were occurring in areas where Awlaki wasn't even residing. So they finally track him to the north of Yemen and they watch him for a month. And he was in a village with 10 small houses, that's it. No armed men, no big camp. They could have easily snatched him from there, but they chose not to. They chose to kill him in a drone strike. So they do that. They authorize a drone strike. They kill Anwar Awlaki on September 30th, 2011. Along with Awlaki, they kill another American citizen who had also not been charged with a crime, named Samir Khan, who's a Pakistani-American living in North Carolina, who had gone to Yemen as an Arabic student and then hooked up with Awlaki. Samir Khan, like Awlaki, was engaged in all sorts of insane speech that I found utterly reprehensible. But Samir Khan's case is even more interesting because the FBI investigated him. And they went to his family and they told his family, this is once he's in Yemen, they told his family, we have no existing indictment of your son. We just want you to try to get him to come home because we're worried about what he's doing over there. But they actually explicitly told the family that he had not been charged with any crime. Samir Khan was killed that day in a drone strike. So here you have two American citizens, albeit engaged in speech I think many of us would find horrendous, who had not been charged with crimes, one of whom, whose family had been told that specifically that there is no indictment against him, they're killed in a drone strike. The reaction in Washington fell into two camps, silence or celebration. Hillary Clinton sounded exactly like John McCain. Dianne Feinstein sounded exactly like John Boehner. The only politician that spoke up about the assassination of these two American citizens was Ron Paul, who at the time was running for the Republican nomination for president. And so you have Ron Paul, and Dennis Kucinich also said something about it at the time. And then you have this sort of celebration. One Congress member said, well, if Samir Khan wasn't an intended target in that strike, and it was just Awlaki, well, then that's just a bonus. He called it a twofer, like a two for one, to kill these two American citizens. So this happens, there's very little discussion, very little debate, and a lot of celebration in Washington. Then 2 weeks later, another drone strike happens, this time in the south of Yemen. And among the people killed in that drone strike was a 16-year-old American citizen who had run away from home at his grandparents' house where he was living because he wanted to find his father, who he hadn't seen for 3 years. And his father was Anwar Awlaki. He had run away from home a day after his 16th birthday, went looking for his father. His father is killed. The revolution in Yemen is happening with the so-called Arab Spring. He's stuck then in this small village with his tribal relatives, and he's out having dinner one night with his teenage cousin Ahmed, who is 17, and several other young people from the tribe when a drone appears above them, fires a Hellfire missile, and blows all of these teenagers up, including this American citizen, Abdulrahman Awlaki, who was born in Denver, Colorado in August of 1995. After this strike happened, and we learned that Abdulrahman Awlaki was killed, the Pentagon, in the form of an anonymous official, had said that he was 21 years old and that he was an Al-Qaeda operative. And then the family produced his birth certificate from the state of Colorado showing that he had just turned 16 years old. I got all of the family's home videos and got a comprehensive sense of who this kid was. I talked to his cousins, his nieces, his nephews, his aunts, his uncles, his friends who we would hang out with in Change Square when they were nonviolently protesting against the US-backed dictatorship. Everyone was dumbfounded at the idea that he had anything to do with Al-Qaeda, except for the fact that his last name was Al-Awlaki and that his father was Anwar Awlaki. This was a kid who was into video games and rap music and drawing cartoons and hanging out with his friends, and he had this unusually long hair. He had almost like it was almost like something between dreadlocks and an afro. And his grandparents were constantly telling him to cut his hair, and he said, "No, this is my trademark. I want to keep my hair big like this." And the sad thing is, you know, his grandfather, when I was at their home in Sana, we were talking about his hair, and he transitions and he says, "You know, but because of his hair, it was one of the only reasons we could identify the boy, because all their bodies were blown up, and we just found part of his skull with his big hair on it." The Obama administration has never explained why Abdulrahman Awlaki was killed. Never. The only in any sort of a position of power that's ever commented on it without being an anonymous U.S. official is Robert Gibbs, who was the White House press secretary and then was the campaign secretary, press secretary for Obama's re-election campaign. Robert Gibbs was approached not by the New York Times or the Washington Post, but by an independent journalist named Sierra Adamson. And Sierra went up to him at one of those post-debate gaggle things, and she asked why they killed Abdulrahman Alaki. And Robert Gibbs said he should have had a more responsible father. You can go and see that clip online, that he should have had a more responsible father. I don't know why Abdulrahman Alaki was killed. All we have to go on are anonymous officials and Robert Gibbs saying he should have had a more responsible father. If they killed that kid because he should have had a more responsible father, that's one of the most heinous Shakespearean crimes of history. To kill a child because of who the parent is, it's as we say in the movie, it's like a tale from Greek mythology. And yet they leave the door open for those of us who have studied this meticulously, to say, what is the alternative theory on this? Who did they kill in that strike? They tried to say they killed this guy named Ibrahim Albana, an Al-Qaeda's propagandist. Ibrahim Albana is still alive and living in Yemen. Who were they trying to kill in that strike? The answer to that question says a lot about who we are as a society. If in a moment when we have a Democratic president who was presented as a transformative figure in American politics, who won the Nobel Peace Prize, who's a constitutional lawyer by training, If he can sit in 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue and decide that a 16-year-old American citizen needs to die because of who his father is, what does that say about us as a society? We expected all sorts of shit from Bush and Cheney. That was Murder Incorporated. That's a boring discussion to have at this point because we know that they were war criminals. But principles aren't tested during times when cartoonish villains like Dick Cheney have some power over our society. Our principles are tested when people we actually might like are in power. Or who have policies or programs in other areas of politics that we agree with. That's when the real principle is tested. And yet you have a deafening silence on Capitol Hill. When Rand Paul filibustered the nomination of John Brennan to be CIA director, it was incredible because it was the Democrats who filibustered his nomination, or stopped his nomination when Obama first tried to make him CIA director in his first term because of concerns about Brennan's views on the torture program and his role in covert CIA programs that went south. But then you just have this one nutty as hell senator from Kentucky who is like the darling of the Tea Party doing the right thing. And I'll give Rand Paul all the credit in the world for what he did that day. Shame on Dick Durbin and others for not doing it. That more than half of Americans support drone strikes, and that support for the drone strikes drop only negligibly when the target in question is an American citizen. At one point, it was 73% of self-identified liberals who supported that policy. I don't believe for one moment that if John McCain had won that election, or Mitt Romney had won that election, that you would see anything vaguely resembling those poll numbers. President Obama and his administration have sold a lot of liberals on the idea that they somehow have invented the cleaner way of waging war. And it's an outright lie. It's a total fabrication. What we're engaged in right now around the world with our drone strikes, with our night raids, with our covert operations, with the ongoing rendition program, with a backdoor way of continuing to torture prisoners, what we are doing is laying the ground for incredible and intense blowback against our society and a further destabilization of many nations around the world. The U.S. continues to be on the wrong side of history throughout the Arab world. It continues to be on the wrong side of history throughout the global south. It continues to be on the wrong side of history in the so-called war on drugs under this administration. And if we don't look in the mirror at some point and realize that all of us have some role that we're playing in this, either through our silence or through our complicity in supporting politicians who engage in these policies or try to normalize some of the most egregious aspects of the Bush-Cheney terror apparatus, we have an obligation to view ourselves as active participants in all of this. Because if we don't, then the big money's always going to win it. People in Washington are always going to be able to do what they want. We can't compete against these huge corporations. Until we get big corporations out of our electoral process, nothing's going to fundamentally change in our country. Nothing. I'm looking forward to talking with Gary, but I just want to say one thing in closing. You know, I was asked by a high school teacher in New Mexico when I was there doing an event with the folks from the Landon Foundation some months ago. She asked me, what can I do with my students to change any of this? And I actually had never been asked that question by a teacher. And I didn't quite know what to say, but I, on the spot, I sort of thought about it, and I ended up saying that you know, part of what happened to me and to Rick Rowley, the director of our film, and to Anthony Arnove and Brenda Coughlin and David Riker, who made the film with us, is that the journey of studying the stories of all these people who live on the other side of the barrel of the gun changed us and changed the way that we view our own role at home in our own society. And I, you know, if I had answers for what any of us could do to change this in an individual way, I would lead with that every night that I'm invited to speak somewhere. And maybe 10 years ago, I would have been so arrogant as to say, well, I think we should do this, 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 and if we tell Congress to do that, that, that. But no, I know enough now from all of my travels to know that we're at ground zero with this discussion once again. We always are at ground zero in a way. But I do think that there is something profound about the power of storytelling. And so what I said to that teacher was, assign your students to research the life and death of one victim of a drone strike. And take it upon yourself to find out every single detail that you can about that individual. And she wrote to me about a month after that, and said that something interesting happened. That almost all of the kids just wrote about Abdulrahman al-Laki, this American citizen. Why? She said because they couldn't find information on victims of drone strikes. So, I mean, and so on one level, I think it's actually, and it's in a way, it's a microcosm of what happens to us as journalists. You know, the best you can do is to internalize the stories of the people who have let you into their lives or somehow you've been allowed into their deaths so that you can share it and keep the narrative alive so that people don't use words like collateral damage or casualties. I sense that in some small way, if all of us did that as some part of our regular life, decided that we were going to know the story of someone who died on the other end of one of our missiles, that in some small way, I actually think there could be meaningful change. It would take a long time, but I do think, and you know, in conjunction with that, in the bigger picture, I think the most important issue that young people in this country can work on, and I alluded to it before, is getting rid of the status of corporations as people, getting them out of the electoral process, and stopping this legalized form of corruption called campaign finance in this country. Because any issue you work on, any issue you work on in the society, whether it's militarism, police brutality, prison industrial complex, the so-called war on drugs, the war against immigrants, all of it in some form or another goes back to who's paying the bills for members of Congress or members of state houses or members of city councils. And if we have to compete with huge corporations and the prison guards unions and all of these special interests, if we have to compete with them, we're going to lose. But the power we'll have is the power of our numbers are greater than their dollars. And we have to strategize, and I don't have the answer, but we have to strategize as to how to take the struggle to those corporations and get them out of this legalized form of corruption in this country. The final thing I'm going to say is this, you know, in thinking about the telling of stories of people like Abdulrahman al-Laki or the people who died in Al-Majla, you know, I memorized the names of all the people killed in that strike because I was looking at this paper with their names on it over and over, and I know every single name of the people killed in that first airstrike that Obama authorized. And we tell the story about this family that was victim of a horrifying special operations night raid in Afghanistan, two pregnant women killed by U.S. forces, and then the soldiers dug the bullets out of their bodies in front of the surviving husband. You know, we told all these stories, we internalized it, it changed us in a serious way. And I was thinking, well, why, you know, we somehow ended up in this weird situation where we get nominated for an Academy Award. And, you know, part of it was amazing because the stories got told in a broader way, and the picture of the Afghan family that we interviewed was shown on CNN when the nomination was announced. But then in another way, it just makes you feel dirty. You know, you're standing on red carpets with creatures that, there's a woman under there somewhere, but it's like a big fur coat, and she's got a microphone, and she has never heard of you or your film, doesn't know what a drone is, and just says, puts her microphone and says, "So, Sundance." And I, you know, at one point someone thought our film was called Dirty Horse. I was asked once about Dirty Whores. A porno director, apparently, and apparently a very solid feminist, too. You know, so, but it's demoralizing. You know, I was joking about the Polaroid camera from Social Worker. I know the people at Social Worker have much more advanced technology than that, but the reason that I sort of bring it up in that context is that, you know, you're standing on these red carpets and, you know, people are talking about Sandra Bullock flailing around in space, and, you know, and you've got, you know, you've got that one guy from that one dude bro comedy, and you don't know his name, but you know who he is, and it's like, hey, man. And then you're, you know, you're, people are sort of humoring you by interviewing you. And so I decided that I wasn't gonna joke around with these people at all anymore, or sort of, you know, acknowledge the farce of it. I would just confront them back, and I would say, well, we made a film about extrajudicial killing and assassination of Americans and non-Americans alike. And I would just say that right to them. And there was almost never a follow-up. Someone asked me once, what are you wearing? And I said, we're all wearing the blood of people around the world. You watch the coverage in the U.S. of, I mean, I remember the coverage of 9/11, and you know, living in New York, you would see, and I'm sure people visited after at that time, you would see all those pictures of people who were missing or unaccounted for, and there would be these incredibly heartbreaking stories about someone's father who they couldn't find, they haven't heard from him in days, if anyone knows where he is, and you know, you could go down and there would be these fences in the West Village and down near the Ground Zero site. And you could just sob your eyes out for hours walking and reading all those stories. And the same was true of the school shootings that we saw, that we've seen happen, that we continue to see happening, which take the lives of far more people than terrorism in this country every year. And why is the media coverage powerful in those cases? Remember the New York Times cover after the Newtown shooting, where they listed the names of all of the kids, and then they had their age after it. And it was black, and the whole cover was black, and it was just the names and the ages. I mean, it was horrifying and gut-wrenching, and you know, you just feel gutted seeing the names, and then 6 years old, the name, and seven, the name, and five, and it's like, fuck, this is like too much. And then, you know, the Boston Marathon bombing happens, and this eight-year-old kid was one of the three people that was killed in it. And that picture that he had drawn of the peace sign went viral all over Facebook and the internet. And there was a Chinese woman who was killed in that bombing. I don't know if any of you remember this. She was a university student. And there was an essay that went viral in China after President Obama spoke about the Boston Marathon bombing, because he named the three dead. And the title of the blog post was Where You Die Matters. And the point of it was that this woman from China, her name would have never been said by the most powerful man in the world if she had died making an iPhone in China for Western consumers. But because she died in the Boston Marathon bombing, her life and death meant something. It meant so much that the most powerful man in the world actually said her name. And we watched the coverage of the school shootings and Boston Marathon bombing and post 9/11. And what is it that stands out about it? What stands out about it is that the victims are made real to us. We learn the dreams that were taken away from the kids. We watch the parents trying to not cry as someone sticks a camera in their face with their bottom lip quivering to try to give a dignified portrayal of who their son was or who their daughter was and not break down in front of the camera. And then you see the people who do actually break down and lose it. We relate to it because it could be our kids, or it could be our brother or our uncle, or it could be us trying to stop the bottom lip from quivering. And I really believe that if we covered victims of war in that same way. If we told the stories of a little girl in the village of Al-Majla whose whole family was blown up in front of her eyes and what that means for her life, you know, or we spent more time focusing on the real widows of Baghdad than the real housewives of Beverly Hills, if we actually had a culture that took so seriously acts of war that we made it our business, to know who is on the other side of those missiles, then I actually think we'd be able to change our country. But in order to do that, we have to radically change the media landscape, and that's an incredible challenge. But at the end of the day, all any of us have in this game, in this equation, is our empathy. And our empathy has to be much greater than their desire to wage a global war. Thank you.
Completely abandoned ship on the Guantanamo fight very, very early on when he realized
that it was going to cost him political capital that he needed for the healthcare battle. He was dealing with the horrible economic meltdown that he had inherited largely from Bush and Cheney. And I think that his team became so overwhelmed at the thought of having to fight all these battles that they consolidated their efforts into a handful of them. And I think they were tremendously ineffective at what they did. But on the issues I report about, put yourself in Obama's shoes, okay? He gets the nomination for the Democratic Party for president, which entitles him by law to receive an all-access briefing from the CIA. And it happened here in the federal building in Chicago. General Michael Hayden comes and gives Obama this briefing and says to him, look, we're living in a world where there are hundreds, if not thousands, of concurrent threats against the American homeland. There are plots to attack tourists in multiple countries around the world, to blow up our embassies, to take down our airliners, to smuggle cartridge bombs onto airplanes. And, you know, you have a limited number of ways that you can respond to this. We can invade some countries, or you can further empower small units from the CIA and the US military to go and take these people out. He then wins election, gets into office, and he just gets avalanched by all of the most powerful people from the military and intelligence complex. Admiral McRaven, David Petraeus, Stanley McChrystal, Michael Hayden, all of these people are saying to the president, if you don't continue these Bush-era authorizations, in fact, if you don't extend them and allow us to start striking in Yemen and Somalia and other countries around the world, Mali, Niger, we're going to get hit again. So Rahm Emanuel and David Axelrod, who were the political hacks of the operation, they're in on these briefings too. And their primary concern has to do with his re-election and his sort of managing his image early on. So to them, the idea of an attack against the United States in the United States of any significant importance would mean a one-term presidency. And I think what they did is bought into the idea that they could kill their way to victory and at the same time say they were waging a smarter war because they weren't going to deploy, with the exception of Afghanistan, large numbers of U.S. troops around the world.
And to that extent, it seems like there was, I mean, first of all, the complicity of the political class. We hear Nancy Pelosi right at the beginning of the book saying, this meeting didn't happen, basically. Everybody who leaves this meeting say, whatever you say nothing. But also, to some extent, and I can make comparisons here with England, Britain, and Ireland, that with Ireland there was the complicity of a large number of British people that their Britishness somehow trumped the rights of the Irish. And that therefore the notion that you might take these people out in some way was okay. That if, for example, the gay issue or the Dreamers, that when there have been movements, then sometimes Obama's had to move. And so taking it away from him as an individual, is it a lack of empathy? Is it the power that comes with being an American person? Is it the lack of infrastructure that disables the creation of the kind of movement that can stop this?
No, it's an interesting question because there are moments when it appears as though Barack Obama's former self is debating his presidential self. You know, I mean, like other journalists.
There's actually a YouTube video of precisely that. Where he's, the quotes from Obama talking about the balance of civil liberties and security before and after.
I mean, I'm even talking about, you know, Obama going back to Columbia University and you know, sort of the younger era, but also through his time, you know, here in Illinois. You know, you can see early on, in October of 2002, and I'm sure some of you were at that speech, Barack Obama gave this major address opposing the Iraq War. And he says in it, you know, I'm not against all wars, I'm against stupid wars. And he basically laid out a Clintonian policy view, which is that if you can sell the American people on the idea that it's a necessary war, then it's fine. But if you know, a majority or even a sizable minority of the public think it's an idiotic war, you should abandon ship on it. There was a political thinking there. Obama, in May of last year, gave an unprecedented speech at the National Defense University where he talked about he never used this word, but talked about the assassination program. talked about drones and confirmed the program publicly for the first time in an official capacity. But you know the first time that Obama ever mentioned the word drones publicly? He was joking at the White House Correspondents' Dinner. He made a joke about a drone strike. And he was asked a question on a YouTube, or on a Google Hangout by a college student about drone strikes. That was the first time that he officially acknowledged that the US does drone strikes. But he gives this major speech in which he says that civilian deaths keep him up at night, that he only wants these strikes to happen in cases where the threat is imminent, where capture is not feasible, and where there is almost near certainty that no civilians will be killed. And he lays all of this out. And you know, I think for a lot of Americans, there would be support for that policy. I'm not saying I support it, I think a lot of Americans would support that policy. The idea that if there's an imminent threat, that you can't capture the person, and that your only real option is to take them out before they blow up the plane or whatever, and no civilians are gonna be killed, then we should do it. And I think that that's the general perception of what the drone program is. The problem with that is that it's totally false that that's what happened even since that speech. After that speech, we had the bombing of a wedding party. There have been two bombings of funerals. There have been multiple cases where more than a dozen civilians have been killed in drone strikes. I think that they've started to believe their own propaganda. You know, John Brennan, who's the CIA director, I call him the assassination czar, he created the architecture for ensuring that the assassination program will continue no matter who's in power next. But what they've done is they've created a mathematical equation that always produces the number zero for civilians killed. Because if you're a military-aged male, which they liberally define as 16 to 75, and you're in a certain region of Yemen or a certain region of Pakistan and you're killed, they would posthumously declare you to have been a militant, which is the term du jour for, we don't know how to categorize this person we just killed, but let's just assume they were a bad guy. And that's sort of the way that they talk about it inside. So I think the president actually believes that they're not killing large numbers of civilians, and which is part of why I think they bought into their own myths about all of this. And it's not about Obama the person. Look, I mean, the most corrupt, worthless group of people in Washington are the people in Capitol Hill. I mean, they're the Democrats have been atrocious under this administration. I bet Obama, when he writes his memoir, is going to say, you know, if more people on Capitol Hill had made it impossible for me to do these things, or threatened to cut off funding for them, then I would have had a leg to stand on and argue against them. Now, I think there's a little bit of BS to that reasoning, but I bet you he's going to say that, and part of it's going to be true, because the Democrats have been awful. Dianne Feinstein is terrible, the chair of the Senate Intelligence Committee. I mean, she is totally a propagandist for the CIA. It's remarkable. If this was a Republican, they would have their gloves off going after these people, because it's their guy, they don't want to touch him.
The description that you draw of the militant, the catch-all term for someone that we're just going to kill, there's an interesting evolution in your descriptions of Alaki and of a few other people in the book who don't start off, as you said, when immediately after 9/11, he is brought on as a voice of reason, the good Muslim as opposed to the bad Muslim. And partly it's events that turn him and turn others. I mean, you've been there. I wonder if you can talk a bit about how the people that you encountered, how their understanding of what America is, what it stands for, what it can do, how that changes with their experience.
You know, it was interesting when Rick Rowley and I were in Afghanistan. At this point, I think it was sometime in maybe early 2010. We were traveling in areas that were controlled by the Taliban or the Haqqani network, which has links to Pakistan's ISI. It was designated as a state sponsor, as a State Department designated terror organization, and is under Treasury Department sanctions. We were traveling in these areas where a lot of fighting has happened between U.S. forces, Taliban, Haqqanis, and it's a very rural part of Afghanistan, exclusively Pashtun ethnicity. And we met on multiple occasions with various elders from different villages, and we would have these sort of consultations where we would sort of go around and ask them all to describe what life is like. And in multiple places, people would say the Russians instead of the Americans. And, you know, we'd ask the translators, like, you know, is it just a mistake? Does he mean the Americans? He says, no, they still think it's the Russians. And I was like, oh, come on, that's BS. And then this poll came out that indicated that 92% of men between the ages of 18 and 35 in Pashtun areas of Afghanistan, 92%, have never heard of 9/11. So if you take those two things and put them together, what does it say? It says that they don't know that it's the Americans that are there. It's just, it could be anyone. It's a foreign occupier. And they've never heard of 9/11, which may sound hard to believe, except when you go there and see there's no radio, there's no cell phone, there's no TV, there's no newspaper. It is truly life in a different century. They have never heard of it. So why do they think anyone is there? They think they're there to take their land. They think they're there literally to steal their livestock. And that gives you a powerful motivation to want to fight back. So that's one story. In the case of Awlaki, you know, this was a guy who came from a very pro-American family. His father had been a Fulbright scholar who loved America, who came here as a young student and then decided he wanted to raise his family here. He loved John F. Kennedy and the sort of idea of the, you know, American dream in its most superficial context. And they were a pretty pro-American family. He was radicalized by the spreading of these wars. Awlaki had supported the U.S. going into Afghanistan and said it had a right to go and capture or kill bin Laden and his network. He said Al-Qaeda had disgraced Islam. But then you've got Guantanamo opening. Then you have Abu Ghraib prison happen. And you see the naked prisoners piled up. And you see dogs being used in an offensive attack mode against Muslims who are being detained. And then reports of female prisoners being raped inside of American military prisons in Iraq. And then you start to hear about the CIA black sites. And then you see what's happening to Muslims in the United States. Businesses being ransacked. A woman was from his mosque was attacked with a baseball bat because she was wearing an abaya and in the aftermath of 9/11. So he sees all of this stuff, and he's being investigated by the FBI and interrogated, and they want him to be an informant, and they're threatening with prosecution for all sorts of things involving prostitution or soliciting sex workers, and they're collapsing down on Awlaki, and he flees. And he goes to Britain for a while, very popular lecturer. At the time there was this severe brutality of the police forces in London and elsewhere. You probably know more about the Birmingham, yeah. And he goes there and speaks at those rallies, and he channels Malcolm X in some of his speeches, and he becomes this very popular preacher among the English-speaking Muslim diaspora around the world. And his sermons are very popular. I've met so many Muslim Americans and British Muslims my age, and you know, around my age, 30s, who all were like, I remember Awlaki, I remember Anwar Awlaki, I saw him speak at this, I heard him speak at that. Well, I listened to hundreds of hours of this man speaking. I would listen to him on the treadmill, I would listen to him in my car. I'm inundated with Anwar Awlaki's sermons. But what's incredible is that you can see the transition that happens. When Yemen starts getting bombed, that was it. In December of 2009, he crosses his line, and he says, I can no longer stand by silently. I'm calling on young people in the West to either fight in their country, young Muslims in the West either fight in their country, or to come and join us in the fronts of jihad. There was a moment where it just clicked, and he crossed, you know, sort of crossed the line. You see that everywhere, Gary. I mean, in Afghanistan, Yemen, Somalia, and all of these in Iraq, I heard in different languages from people of different ethnicities the same sentiment. When my wife was killed in the night raid, when you know my family was killed in the drone strike, you know, when I was maimed and beaten in the prison, I decided that I want to put on a suicide vest and blow myself up among the Americans. We are creating a whole new generation of enemies, and they're not necessarily terrorists. In fact, they're most likely not terrorists.
Not yet.
They may not ever even be. I mean, is someone a terrorist? This is the terrorism. The term terrorism is a relative term. Of course, terrorism never applies to the actions of the United States or its allies or Israel or any other country. It's only people who strap bombs to their bodies and go on a bus or, you know, are engaged in attacking supply lines of the U.S. military going into Afghanistan. What I'm saying is that we are creating people who will have a legitimate score to settle with us. And that's more frightening than terrorism, because they have something they are willing to die for a very legitimate belief, and that is that their loved ones were killed without any reason whatsoever, and nothing has been done to make it right or attempted to make it right.
I want to end. I want to move on to your transition from walking through the streets of Mogadishu looking for the right warlord to red carpet in Los Angeles, and ask what do you feel was gained and what do you feel was lost in the transition from the book to the film?
I mean, we had to edit whole countries out of the film. For some time we wanted to, Pakistan almost doesn't appear in the film at all, in part because, I don't believe there's been adequate media coverage of Pakistan, but there's been a lot more than the other countries that we've featured in our film. I also was passionately against being in the film myself.
You lost that one.
I lost that one in a big way. We really struggled with how to tell that story. And we had like a 4-hour rough cut of it where I wasn't present as myself in the film, and I preferred that version of it, but I don't think any of you would have watched a 4-hour documentary without breaking it into a million pieces. So basically what happened is Rick Rowley and my co-writer David Riker sort of convinced me that this is the most effective way to tell the story. And to be honest, I come from an anti-racist background, and I've done a lot of activism against the death penalty, against police brutality, against prisons, and I was very sensitive to the fact that it seemed that we were now going to make a film that I call the Magic Cracker film, where you have the white guy who has to come in and make sense of all the problems and sew it up at the end. So you asked what was lost in it. I still can't. I have trouble watching the film, even when I have to. I'm supposed to go through screenings.
Yeah, Rowley said you cringe.
I cringe for a number of reasons. I cringe because I still. It's real. These are all people that are real to me, and that I know. And I find it really hard to. I don't want to in my own. I don't know if this makes sense, but in my own soul, I don't want to commodify their suffering. And I feel like if I watch the movie 40 times, I'm commodifying in my own. It's no longer real. It's just like, oh, it's that scene. I don't want ever to feel that way about the people who let us into their lives. But also, I'm conflicted about being in the film in the way that I am. I'm a public person in a lot of ways, but I'm also a fiercely private person in other ways. It's weird. People come, I've never in my life would be approached by anyone, really, except at a conference or something, saying, I know you. Or now it's very, very strange. I had an embarrassing moment on the red carpet because this woman, this actress named Kristen Bell, you guys know who she is, Kristen Bell? Okay, she's apparently a celebrity. Kristen Bell, what is she, what's her thing? She's the voice of, okay, everyone, you guys know. All right, so she's blonde, and she's, got her big gown on, and she and her husband, her boyfriend, Dax Shepard is his name, who's like one of those dude bro guys that you've seen, and you would recognize him, you probably don't know his name. Anyway, they came up to me, and they said, we just watched your film last night. This is on the red carpet. And I recognize him from like some really weird movie with Will Arnett where he was doing a bong hit in a prison. I'm like, yeah, big fan of your, yes, nice to meet you, or whatever. So I meet these guys, and then I get ushered over, and I'm talking to the New York Times carpet blogger person, the one who does the red carpet stuff, and the Wall Street Journal. I'm talking to those two reporters there. And they said, so, what's it been like here? I'm like, oh, it's really weird. I just had this interaction with Kristen Stewart. It wasn't Kristen Stewart, it was Kristen Bell. Kristen Stewart's one from the vampire movies, right? The Twilight. So I'm telling this whole story about Kristen Stewart coming to me, and the New York Times woman's like, Kristen Stewart's here? And I'm like, yeah, she's right over there with her boyfriend or husband or whatever. And then my publicist is like, Kristen Bell, Kristen Bell. I go, I'm sorry, oh, God. All of that was about Kristen Bell. It was weird. And then Pharrell comes walking in wearing shorts. And, this is what it's, we're there and I'm doing these interviews next to, like, Al Roker yucking it up with someone. And I'm like, and then the drone strike did this, and then the night raid did that. And it's fucking mind-blowing. It's almost, I when I sat there during the whole thing, when Ellen DeGeneres comes out, I was just like, where the hell are we? Like, this is, so I was with Rick, and he and I both, covered war for a long time. And it's just like, we gotta get the fuck out of here. And we spent most of our time at that ceremony out in the lobby drinking. You know, they have a military-style checkpoint. When you go, so what happens, putting you all in the know now, what happens is they inundate you with all this paperwork from the Academy Awards with all these security passes, and there's different levels of passes and everything. And when you get in a car to go to this thing, you have to have three levels of security to get past the thing. When we pulled up to the Dolby Theater where it is, there was a SWAT teams out, and they had concrete blocks so that you had to snake the car around, and they make you roll down your window as you go through this whole block of security. They have bomb sniffing dogs, they have the little mirror things under the cars. I mean, it was, Rick and I were like, wow, we feel at home here. Like, it's like it really, you know, so it's, and as you're driving by with the windows open, you know, there's all these people on these bleachers, like wanting to see in who it is, and multiple times when we go back, they'll be like, who is that? And a couple times I got mistook for someone else. Like, they thought I was this guy named, I got in an argument with a photographer who insisted that I was someone named Taylor Kitsch. Is that someone? Taylor Kitsch, yeah. And I said, I assure you that I'm not. And he said, oh, come on, Taylor, just stop for one picture. I'm like, I'm not whoever that is. I don't even know who that is.
You should have stopped.
Well, on behalf of all of us in Hollywood, I just want to say Obama needs to end these wars.
In a recent interview with the Guardian News, you were asked, is it possible to have a life beyond the war zone? And you say it can, but it takes a special kind of person to agree to be in a relationship with a war reporter. The battlefields are filled with broken marriages. I remember during a really intense period in Iraq, the circle of journalists I was around were all just broken, shattered people. And during the hell of that war, a lot of people were drinking themselves into oblivion. How do you come? You have a daughter, you have a life in Brooklyn, and you are, and then in and out of kind of, you know, looking for warlords in Somalia or kind of in these areas in Yemen. How do you escape that trap? Do you escape that trap?
You know, I'll forgive you for this, but I never talk about the fact that I have a daughter.
I'm sorry.
No, excuse you. No, it's okay actually. I took her to the Oscars with me. I mean, I'm a single parent, and I have full custody of my daughter, and she goes to school, you know, in Brooklyn, and she sacrificed an enormous amount for this project. And you know, part of why I have kept her away from anything I do in public is I don't ever want to subject anyone that I love to any kind of harassment or hatred. You know, my mom, who's very active on Facebook and used to be very active on Flickr, at one point when I did an expose in New Orleans, I posted some pictures of some police officers looting a store on my personal Flickr page, and then my mom commented on one of those pictures, and those officers then went after me, and they actually went after my mom, and they were calling her a bitch, and then they were started commenting on all these pictures, including some that had, you know, my daughter and other members of our family, and they started harassing other members of our family. You know, and I get death threats. I have the day that our movie came out, someone on a listserv run by private security companies posted my address online and said people should go to my house and tell me what they think of me. So the film company made me, I had to have, for the first time in my life, I had to have a bodyguard because they were concerned that it was, they thought it was like a legitimate threat that someone was gonna actually do it. So I had to have someone travel around for me, which I hate. You know, so I try to keep my family away from any of the negative side or the potential consequences of what I do. Having said that, my daughter has selfies now with Leo DiCaprio. Meryl Streep called her darling. I tried to spread the love around my family too. So my brother, who was referred to as my little brother in the piece, though he's like six, is actually a year younger than me. I brought him to the nominee luncheon thing, and then my mom came to the Academy Awards. And I brought my sister to a party. They have these things called swag bag parties, yes, where you get to take all this stuff. But what I didn't know is that in order to get this stuff, you have to like take a picture with their product. Only for my sister am I going to be featured in some Japanese newspaper ad for a wonderful cream that'll just be the face for your voice.
So, finally, moving on, The Intercept, this new project with Glenn, Laura, Liana, Matt Taibbi, I think is now involved. Just tell us a little bit about what that is, what you envision this to be.
Well, so we started this news organization called The Intercept, which is at theintercept.org, and it came about in kind of a, to me, an internally hysterical way. I was in Rio at Glenn's house with the canine planted in the apes, and he and I were talking about, at the time Glenn was at The Guardian, I was at The Nation magazine, and Glenn and I had been talking for some time. We were going to be collaborating on a series of pieces, which we, now that I'm finishing with all this stuff, we'll go back to doing. We did one piece, but we have several more we're working on together. We were talking about not quitting our jobs and starting something new, but creating a website with Laura Poitras, who's a friend of ours and also obviously a main player in the Snowden saga, about creating a website where we could publish quicker turnaround things or put documents if one of our employers or bigger outlets we work with didn't want to publish them, just creating basically another site that we would run informally. We were maybe going to raise money to hire one person to help administer it. And as we were discussing that, and it was not even in really a real form, Glenn gets this email from a mutual friend of his and Pierre Omidyar, who is the founder of eBay and like the 100th richest man in the world. I think he's worth like $9 billion. All I know is what I Google about the guy, but it's not. I truly think he's worth about $9 billion. And Pierre was asking Glenn if, he said he wanted to, he was gonna build a new news organization, that he had contemplated buying the Washington Post and decided not to. And wanted to know if Glenn wanted to contribute, you know, make like by writing a column or doing something, and if he had other people that he wanted to bring on board to also contribute to it. No one has to quit their job, you know, this would be an additional thing. That was the sort of tone of it. So I was out with Glenn at dinner that night. Glenn's like, I think we should just pitch him on the whole thing, like on this site. And so then the next day, Glenn's on the phone with Pierre saying, Jeremy and Laura and I have been talking about doing this. Would you want to work together on it? And that's how it started. And originally, it was going to be First Look Media, which is the parent entity, was going to be in sort of a full spectrum news operation with sports, entertainment, politics, foreign policy, the Snowden documents, obviously, and the NSA story, you know, all aspects of reporting. And what ultimately was decided as we started to build the organization was that we would create several digital magazines, and they would all be centered around a journalist or a team of journalists who already sort of have a track record in that area of coverage. So the economic section is going to be built around Matt Taibbi, and he's going to put together a team of people. Glenn and Laura and I right now are at The Intercept, and we're slowly building a team of people. It is only in beta form. I mean, we did this very quickly to get it up because of the urgency of trying to get the reporting on the Snowden documents out. But it eventually will take on a different form, and we're going to build a much bigger structure. We also have, you know, when you start an organization like this and you have the politics that we do, you know, we want to build an incredibly diverse organization with all sorts of voices represented and all kinds of people employed. And, you know, there's been criticism that I think is valid from the outside about the structure and the demographics of some of the early hires. But it's something that from even before we had a name for the site, that we've had a game plan for. And in the coming months, I think people are going to see a very seriously diverse crew of people that are going to be employed by The Intercept and the other magazines that we're going to publish.
So you're going to carry on doing the same kind of work, or is it in any way going to be different to what you've been doing before?
Me personally?
Mm.
I'm burned out, man, from this. I don't mean I'm burned out like I want to leave journalism or something like that. I just mean that I think that at a moment, if you ever become cynical, you know, about your work or about the sort of stories that you're covering, and you stop internalizing the gravity of those situations, it's time for a break. I haven't gotten to that point, but I don't want to hit it. And so, you know, I'm going to continue to do work that I think will be helpful to people in terms of providing them with information they can use to make informed decisions. But I'm not sure what, I'm not going to go and sort of now start an expose about Lockheed Martin or something. I mean, I want to be a, I just want to be a Daily Grind reporter for a while and go back to getting my fingernails dirty on the Daily Grind.
Well, no, may your fingernails be dirty. Long may you grind. I think all of us tonight have been really enlightened and inspired by what you've got to say. I want to say thank you very much, Jeremy. So buy the books there and we will sign them here. Thank you.